Hello and welcome to Dental Studies Simplified. I'm Dr. Ankita Kotecha, and in today's video we are going to discuss the terminologies and the armamentarium, that is chapter number 2 of the Carl Misch textbook. Please note the content of this video is entirely from the chapter number 2 of the textbook Carl Misch. Before beginning the video, let me tell you this video is going to be quite lengthy. But don't worry, I will be providing a timeline wherein I will mention at which point of time which topic is being discussed so that you can plan how to watch this video. Okay, but please bear with me. I have been receiving various emails telling that they are having exams next week and they want me to discuss implants as much as possible. So for their sake, I am trying to cover more topic, more syllabus in single video, but don't worry, there won't be any confusions or overlapping. I will discuss every topic clearly with a good amount of separation between the topics so that there is no confusion, and also I will provide a timeline of various topics that are discussed in this video. So let us begin with the video for today. We'll be mainly discussing two topics, terminologies and then armamentarium. Okay, so first we will begin with the terminologies. Okay, so under terminology, our most important terminology is, as we all know, osseo integration. Osseo means bone. Integration means to integrate, to unite, to meet. Okay, so the standard definition as per Brainmark is direct contact or direct meeting of the bone and the implant. Here it is implant. Okay, why direct? Because if it is a natural tooth, we have periodontal ligament, the periodontium, in between the tooth and bone. They are not in direct contact, otherwise it will be ankylosis. Okay, so here the bone and integration of bone with implant, they are in direct contact. They are in direct contact, they are not in indirect contact. So please be very attentive. They are in direct contact. Let me write it for you. So this is osseo integration. Now this osseo integration is also called as, also known as secondary stability. So now you must be wondering, what is primary stability? If this is secondary stability, then what is primary stability? Okay. Primary stability is the stability that is attained at the time of implant insertion. Now all of you who have performed implant procedure will be quite familiar with it, but others, please don't worry, this is not that hard. We will try to make it as simple and easy. Please make sure you have the PDF or the textbook with you simultaneously to refer to the various clinical and the armamentarium images and illustrations given in the textbook. I have already shared the link with all of you of Carl Misch PDF. Please make sure or make an arrangement to keep it open with you simultaneously while watching this video, just to make things easier. Not a compulsion, but just to make things easier. It will be easy for you to understand the things if you have the textbook with open with you simultaneously. Okay. So if you have inserted, let's say if we have performed an implant procedure and we have inserted implant, the stability that is attained at that point of time, at the time of insertion, is called primary stability, also known as initial stability. Primary stability or initial stability. This stability is mainly determined by the implant macrostructure, the characteristics of the implant, the type of implant, the macrostructure of the implant, and the surgical procedure, both of them combined together will determine the primary stability, the stability attained at the time of insertion. Now, once the implant is inserted and we have attained or achieved our primary stability, now this bone implant unit will undergo healing process. Okay, they enter the healing phase, and as the healing progress, then they attain secondary stability, which is nothing but osseointegration. Clear till now? So first we attain primary stability. This primary stability over the period of time reduces, but our biological stability increases, that is, we progress in terms of healing to attain secondary stability. So if you have the textbook with you, just refer to that graph. Let's say this is the primary stability graph. I'm drawing it in dots. So at the time of insertion, day 0 and let's say day 60, just for instance, the primary stability is at its peak, which eventually reduces. But the biological, the secondary stability, which is 0 at the time of insertion, as we progress in the healing, increases. Okay, the lining is secondary stability, the dots are primary stability, and this is total stability. This period between primary stability and secondary stability, in between which the total stability is inadequate or insufficient, okay, this is called stability dip. Clear till now? We have discussed primary stability attained at the time of insertion, mainly determined by the implant macrostructure and the surgical procedure. Secondary stability, also known as implant osseointegration, which is attained at the end of the healing process. Okay, at the end of this healing process, the secondary stability is attained, which is called osseointegration. The difference between the two, that gap between the two until the secondary stability is attained, in between which the total stability is unstable or inadequate, insufficient, is called stability dip. Now there is one more terminology in the textbook, BIC, bone to implant contact. Now once this secondary stability is attained, this implant, amount of surface of implant in contact with bone. Now they are talking about surface, mainly they are talking about surface. Till now we were discussing stability, now we are discussing about surface. The surface contact between the two is called bone to implant contact. Okay, now this is the criteria used in the research materials. Okay, the research articles, the research criteria involves BIC, bone to implant contact. So clear till now? Primary stability, secondary stability, dip and BIC. Now we will discuss the Albrechtsen and colleagues criteria to define a successful implant. Not every implant can be termed as successful. To be considered as a successful implant procedure, Albrechtsen and colleagues, they have listed four major criteria. The first is the implant. As we all know, or as we understand, the implant, if inserted, certain portion of implant is remain exposed. Okay. There are many ways to place implants. We will discuss that later on, but for now, the common one is where the implant is kept, a little portion of implant, the coronal portion of implant is kept exposed. So that is unattached. It's not attached to the bone. Let's say here, this is the implant. Okay. So this portion is not in contact with bone. So the first criteria is this unattached portion of implant should be immobile. It should not be mobile. Okay. So unattached portion should be immobile. Clear? The second criteria, no pain, no discomfort and no infection. Clear? The third criteria, marginal bone loss annually less than 0.2 mm after first year. Like we discussed in the last video, anything that has to go wrong with implant will mainly or most commonly happen in the first year. After 1 year, hardly there should be anything happening with it, but if at all it happens at the soft tissue level or maybe of the mucositis. Okay, that is soft tissue level and the bone. But the bone thing usually does not happen after 1 year because it attains the secondary stability. So marginal bone loss annually of less than 0.2 mm after 1 year. So what all we discussed till now? The unattached portion should be immobile, no pain, no discomfort and no infection. Marginal bone loss annually after 1 year. And the fourth point is absence of any radial lucency between the bone and implant. Okay. So bone and implant should be in direct contact. There shouldn't be any radial lucency between bone and implant. So these are the four criteria by Albrechtsen and colleague to determine or define an implant as a successful implant. Okay. So revision till now: primary stability, secondary stability, stability dip, and bone to implant contact. And the four criteria to define it to be as a successful implant. Now we will discuss how to determine that stability. Till now we have been discussing stability. Now we will discuss how to determine that stability. So mainly the stability, the primary stability is usually and firstly, first and foremost way to decide or determine the stability is the insertion torque. Soon after implant placement, we check for the torque. If that torque value is attained, that means primary stability is achieved. Okay, insertion torque, that's called insertion torque. Okay, the second method and the most common method again is resonance frequency analysis. This is what resonance frequency analysis, a pencil kind of device. Brand names, we have Austell and we have Penguin. Okay, if you check the textbook, they have given the photograph of Penguin instrument. Okay, and what they do, this mainly this analysis implant stability quotient. Okay, implant stability quotient, which falls, the values of which falls in the range of 1 to 100. Okay, it is like you place this device on that implant tooth and implant crown, and it mimics the clinical load. Okay, and it gives you the idea of the stability of the implant. So on that device, if you see that photograph, you will see the value 75. So anywhere from 1 to 100, it gives you the value of the stability of implant. So this is a good enough method to determine primary stability and also stability over the period of time, so that you can follow up. We can make a follow up of the progress. The value over the period of time should ideally increase. But God forbid, or unfortunately, in the worst case scenario, if it is deteriorating, then also we will come to know from the values. Okay, so these values will give us the hint or the idea about the stability. Okay, so these are the two main methods. One is insertion torque, second one is RFA. This is the most commonly thing used clinically. Okay, there are two more methods mentioned in the textbook, but are outdated and no more recommended. But just to mention them here. It's percussion method, our regular routine procedure of percussion, where we tap the implant or tooth with our blunt end of the instrument. So by just the sound of the instrument, okay, the quality of the sound, we assess the thing. Okay, but again not recommended. And fourth one is reverse torque testing. Okay, the name itself tells you, reverse torque testing. It is unscrewing, giving the torque to the implant in the unscrewing direction. So obviously it is not recommended. It's highly avoidable. Sorry. Okay. So this is how we determine stability. So till now, osseo integration, also called as secondary stability. Before that, we have primary stability attained at the time of insertion. The period or the gap between the two, stability dip. And then we have bone to implant contact, BIC, Albrechtsen's criteria, four criteria: no pain, no discomfort, no infection, no radial lucency between bone and implants, and the unattached portion should be immobile, and marginal bone loss of less than 0.2 mm annually after 1 year. Okay, so after 1 year onwards we should calculate like that. And then we have methods to determine stability, four methods: implant insertion torque, resonance frequency analysis by devices such as Austell and Penguin, which measures implant stability quotient falling in the range of 1 to 100. And then the two methods which are outdated and not recommended, highly avoidable, it shouldn't be performed at all: percussion and reverse torque testing. So we have done first part of the video. Now we will discuss the second part, that is types of implants. Now we will begin with types of implants. I hope the content till here is clear to all of you. Clear? Now we will begin with types of implants. So under types of implants, we have endosteal or endosseous, periosteal and transosteal. Very simple, as the name suggests, endosteal or endosseous means within the bone, periosteal means above the bone or around the bone, and transosteal means through and through the bone. Okay, so out of these three, the most common one is endosteal or endosseous. So we will begin with endosteal for now and discuss the two later on. Okay, so for now, endosteal. Again, endosteal means within the bone. Remember, endosteal implants means the implant is inserted within the bone. So where alveolar bone or at max the basal bone. Clear? Again, under endosteal, we have two types: blade shape, based on the shape, blade shape and root form. It's like a form of the root, shape of a root. It mimics the shape of a root, and blade form. So blade form is somewhat like this, a flat thing. Okay, it has such structure, flat structure. Okay, this blade shape was formerly used in cases where ridge augmentation was not possible, or as an alternative to ridge augmentation, that is in the narrow ridges. Clear? But then we have multiple options in the root form, so this blade form got little outdated. Okay, so under root form, now that we know that root form is commonly used, again under root form we have two types: cylinder and screw shape. Okay, see, both of them are cylindrical, but what is different that makes this screw shape better than cylinder? So first we'll discuss cylinder. The name itself tells, cylinder shape means two parallel walls. This is cylinder shape. See, this cylinder instrument, the cylinder implant is pushed or tapped into the implant osteotomy. Please refer the figures in the textbook simultaneously. Okay, so this is cylinder. Okay, two parallel walls and it is pushed or tapped into the implant osteotomy, and plain surface. Okay, no screws or threads or anything like that, plain surface. What is done at max, majorly the surface treatment is performed to roughen the surface so as to provide some frictional resistance during dislodgement. Okay, so that surface treatment is done by means of hydroxyapatite or plasma therapy, titanium plasma therapy, or even some small metal balls are sintered into the implant surface, okay, to provide some roughness, okay, so as to create some friction, that's all. But what happens, this implant surface therapy leads to certain complications of implants. That is why now cylinders are not used anymore. Okay, so now we are left with the latest and the most commonly used, screw shape. Okay, now again, they are also cylindrical. The original Brennemark design, if you see, it was parallel, cylindrical, parallel to parallel walls. But now the latest designs which we have, they are slightly tapered. That is, the diameter reduces as we approach the apex or the apical portion. Plus the name screw shape, why screw? Are you familiar with the screw? Hindi mein khilli bolte hai, aisa. Okay, the screw which we drill into the walls for hanging something, for example my board. Okay, so such screw threads are present on this implant surface. Okay, it's this spiraling thing onto the implant surface. This provides that extra retention to our implants. So that is why the name screw shapes. The two major difference between cylinder and screw shape, both of them are root form, but the two major difference, one is the screw threads, second is slightly tapered body rather than a parallel cylindrical form. Okay, so now we have concluded that screw shaped implants are the most commonly used. Revision till here: endosteal, periosteal and transosteal. Endosteal means within, periosteal means around and above, transosteal means through and through. Under endosteal we have blade and root form, and under root form we have cylindrical, cylinder, which is also known as press fit because of the method of insertion. It is pushed or tapped into the implant osteotomy, whereas here an osteotomy site is prepared with multiple drills, and then finally the screw is inserted and is not rather pushed into the osteotomy site. It is drilled and it is inserted in the same fashion, so that the screw which are created, the screw thread conformation which is created by the drills inside that osteotomy site, they both conform to each other. Okay, they fit in. Clear? So this is how the screw shaped implants are inserted, not just pushed or tapped into it. Clear? So now we will proceed with screw shape. Again, under screw shape we have various subdivisions based on one or the other features. Please listen carefully. The first feature is the number of units. Don't get confused. See, implant is a single unit thing only, implant. But then there is one another part of implant which is called a platform or a connector. Okay, that platform gives a platform for implant to connect to various other components. What is that component? See, implant is the first unit, and that component is abutment onto which our crown will be placed. So this abutment here is counted as second unit. So this is two piece. Okay, and contrary to this, wherein we have two separate pieces, we have one piece in which the implant and the abutment are connected. This is single piece, one piece. Implant and abutment are joined, combined together. They are not separate units, they are combined into a single unit which is called one piece, because implant plus abutment is equal to one piece, single piece. Versus this part, this implant style, wherein we have two different pieces. One piece is implant, the other piece is abutment. Okay, so this is the first subdivision under screw shaped implants, one piece versus two piece. Please refer the textbook figure simultaneously to get better clarity onto it. A figure 2.9 2.10. okay, and then the second subdivision is based on diameter. Okay, we have small diameter implants. See, no literature gives you clear-cut demarcation, at least I did not come across, but based on my observations till now of the various kits that I have come across and utilized, my personal experience with Nobel BioCare, it usually started from 3.4. Okay, so my observation is anything above 3 mm is a regular implant, a regular diameter implant. Anything less than 3 mm, even the textbook tells you this. The diameter of small diameter implant in the textbook, it tells 1.8 to 2.9 mm. So anything 3 and above is a regular implant, less than 3 mm is a small diameter implant. Now where to use this small diameter implant? Again, in the thin ridges, okay, where augmentation cannot be performed, or again as an alternative to augmentation. But there are multiple indications of small diameter implant apart from prosthetic. Small diameter implants can also be used in orthodontics as anchorage, and even in pedodontics as transitional implants. You may also refer to the textbooks of orthodontics and pedodontics to get a better insight into this particular topic, small diameter implants. Because as per my knowledge, orthodontics use them as anchorage and pedodontics use them as transitional implants. So refer to their respective texts to know better, to know these small diameter implants better. But as per the prosthetics and the Carl Misch textbook, as we are following, small diameter implants in the range 1.8 to 2.9 mm indicated in thin ridges. And yes, this is one option versus our regular diameter, where we have small and so on. Clear? Narrow, sorry, not small. Narrow words, narrow and so on words. And then the third thing we have is based on the level at which implant is inserted. Remember, we discussed Albrechtsen criteria just now. Therein, the first point was the unattached portion of the implant should be immobile. So, how is that unattached portion obtained? So, the level is tissue level versus bone level. See, if it is at bone level, hardly any unattached portion, because the implant collar, the surface is at the level of alveolar crest. Whereas if it is a tissue level, some amount of implant is above the bone so as to match the crest of the soft tissue. Let me draw here. See, this is the soft tissue and here the bone, and then the implant is somewhere here. Again the bone and the soft tissue. Okay. So, this is the bone level and this is the soft tissue level. So, the implant is at the crest of the tissue, whereas bone level is here. This is the level of bone and this is the level of implant. The implant level and the bone crest level matches. Here the implant and the soft tissue level matches. Okay. So, this is how these types of implants are thus created, tissue level and bone level, based on the placement, the level of implant placement. Now you may ask, why these two levels? What is the advantage with either of them, or what is the drawback with either of them? We'll discuss one by one. Tissue level, the advantage they tried to create is to give a space for the biologic width to develop, so that there is no marginal bone loss, so as to give space for the biologic width to develop. Whereas with the implant at the bone level, what will happen otherwise, this bone loss will occur, so that after this bone loss occurs, there the biologic width will develop. Okay. So here the biologic width is developed at the cost of marginal bone. Okay. Here that marginal bone loss is minimalized. Clear? Minimized. And this is the advantage of tissue level versus bone level. But let me inform you, there is advancement here as well. We have something called as platform switching, a whole new concept wherein this platform, as I told you here, there are two pieces, implant and abutment, but before connecting the abutment with implant, there is one more component inside the implant called platform. That platform of implant is switched. We'll discuss that concept later on. It comes in this chapter and I'll discuss it in the same video. But later on, okay. So for now, just remember there is a concept of platform switching, with the help of which this marginal bone loss is minimized here as well. So now what remains to be discussed is, then what is the drawback? See, we discussed the benefit of tissue level versus bone level. That is, the marginal bone loss is minimum here. But then the drawback is the soft tissue emergence profile is not in our hands, okay? Because the soft tissue is already present and that is only going to form around it. But here we have entirely new set of soft tissue, a new way of creating the soft tissue profile around it, okay? Here the implant is already placed at the level of soft tissue, so the soft tissue profile manipulation is not much possible. Whereas here, the entire soft tissue manipulation is still in our hands and we can still try to create a better emergence profile. So, aesthetics outcome will be much better with implant at the bone level. So, these are the benefits and drawbacks of individual types of bone implant level placement. Okay. So, summary till now. Types of implants: endosteal, periosteal and transosteal. Under endosteal, we have blade form and root form. Under root form, we have cylinder and screw. And under screw shape, we have, based on number of units, one piece versus two piece. Based on the diameter, small diameter implants. And based on the level of the implant placement, we have tissue level versus bone level. Okay, now we will proceed further to discuss the implant macrostructure and microstructure. Okay. I hope the content is clear till here now. Okay, we will now proceed with the macrostructure and microstructure. Okay. Okay, so under implant, macrostructure and microstructure. First, we will discuss macrostructure. Okay. Macrostructure and microstructure. So, under macrostructure, we have mainly the overall shape. Okay. The macrostructure is defined by overall shape of the implant. Under overall shape, we have either parallel walls, the parallel, that is cylinder, versus tapered, which you can see in this schematic diagram. I'm sorry for this rough diagram. Please bear with my drawings. And that's why I always repeatedly tell you to keep textbook beside you so that you don't get more confused with my stupid drawings. I'm sorry for that. But under macrostructure, we have parallel versus tapered walls. Then we have tapping, self-tapping or non-tapping. And then we have threads. Again, threads, there are two types. One is implant thread, that is thread onto the implant, and micro threads, that is thread at the collar. Okay. And under microstructure, we have surface thread. So, under macrostructure, no more confusion, we are first discussing macrostructure followed by microstructure. So, under macrostructure, the first point is parallel versus tapered. Of course, we have already understood by now, the tapered surface wall implant is better than parallel wall because it provides better primary stability, more primary stability compared to parallel one. Okay, so here the tapered wings. Because there are many more advantages associated with tapered form. One is primary stability. Another one is it is almost similar to the root form. And the tapering gives us a better confidence to insert the implant, making sure that we are not gonna perforate the bone. Because it is tapering at the apex. Okay, so the bone for perforation, either buccal or lingual wall perforation, chances are highly unlikely. I'm not saying absolutely zero. Yes, it can happen, but very less chances. And so it gives you a sense of safety. Yes. So the tapered wall implants will. Coming to self-tapping versus non-tapping. See, earlier we used to perform with the non-tapping implants. I remember doing it with non-tapping implants. After performing the various drills in the increasing order of their diameter, we used to end it with one last drill, which used to be screw tap, okay, or the thread former. Clear? So see, the terminology or the name of the instrument varies from kit to kit, but yeah, it is either called screw tapping or thread forming. That is, we are creating the negative conformation of the thread present onto the implant. Okay, so that when this implant is inserted into the osteotomy site, the threads on the implant will conform or fit into the negative conformations of the implant threads that are created by the screw tap or the thread formers. Okay. So, yes, that is non-tapping. That means one additional step is required. Whereas self-tapping implants, they are better and they are used now because of the advantage of a quicker process. That is, the process is performed faster. Implant insertion plus the thread creation or the bone cutting required for the thread conformation, both are happening simultaneously in a single step. Whereas for the non-tapping one, we have to first create the taps, that is the threads, with the help of thread former or screw taps, and then insert the implant. So two separate steps. So obviously it's time consuming, and two steps are required. Whereas here in a single step, both the process or both the purpose are served. So tapping wheels here. Coming to threads. See, on the threads, there are two types of thread: implant thread and micro thread. Micro thread, as I already told, at the collar. They are a set of small threads, tiny threads, mini threads, we can call them mini threads, at the collar to dissipate or to distribute the forces which are arising at the collar of the implant. Clear? Whereas the main set of threads are on the implants, these spirals, as we see on our screw. Clear? So, if we try to study this thread, see, there are mainly four types of thread. V shape, this is V shape, then we have square shaped, then we have buttressing, and then we have reverse buttressing. Okay, reverse buttressing hardly used in dentistry. So here we are discussing V shape. So we will try to understand the various terminologies associated with the thread. So this standing line of the V shape, this standing line is called crest. Okay, this crest is mainly connecting the two walls of the thread. This is the root of the implant. So the diameter at the crest is called outer diameter. The diameter at the root is called inner diameter. And if we draw a perpendicular axis, and let's say these are the helix of the screw, as you can see here. So this angulation is called helix angle, and the distance between two threads is called pitch, and the distance or the amount of the length of the implant inserted in one turn is called lead. Clear? I'll repeat once again. This standing line portion of the V is called the crest, which connects the two walls of the thread. The diameter at the V is called outer diameter, sorry, at the crest is called outer diameter, and at the root, inner diameter. The angulation of these screws with the perpendicular axis, helix angle. The distance between the two threads, pitch, and the amount of or the length of the implant insertion happening in a single turn is called lead. Okay, so this is about implant threads. Talking about the micro threads, we discussed that in implant threads, there are two threads, implant threads and micro threads. Micro threads are these threads which are at the collar of the implant so as to distribute the forces that are arising at the collar of the implant. Okay. So, a brief summary of macro structure, parallel wall versus tapered wall wins, and self-tapping versus non-tapping, self-tapping again wins, although a bit aggressive, but it does the two-in-one job, okay, insertion as well as thread forming or the bone cutting point, a job at the same time. And implant threads, V-shaped, square-shaped, buttressing and reverse buttressing, okay, and the micro threads. Now we will discuss the micro structure. Don't get confused, we just discussed micro threads. Now we will discuss the micro structure. Micro threads falls under the macro structure category. Now under micro structure we have the surface therapy. So usually the titanium implants, usually when they are exposed to air, the layer of titanium oxide is created. Okay. So we do something to promote the osteointegration process, okay, something to promote that. So we do some surface therapy just to enhance osteo. So the surface therapy, if we add something, it's additive, and if we remove something, it's subtractive, okay. So under additive, we have hydroxyapatite coating, titanium plasma spray, and anodization of the titanium oxide layer. And under subtractive, we have lasers, acid etching, and blasting with silicone. Okay, so by doing either of these procedures, we create a rough surface, a surface favorable or to promote osseointegration. Okay, so a quick summary till now. We started with osseointegration, which is called secondary stability. We discussed primary stability, which is attained at the time of insertion, and the gap between the two, which is called stability tip. Then we have a terminology called bone implant contact, then Albrechtsen criteria, four criteria for a successful implant, lack of mobility of the unattached portion, no pain, no discomfort and no infection. Then no radiolucency between bone and implant, and marginal bone loss of less than 0.2 mm annually after first year. Then we discussed methods to determine stability. First is insertion torque, then we have resonance frequency analysis, and then we have the other two methods which are outdated, percussion and reverse torque testing. Then we discussed types of implants, endosteal, periosteal and transosteal. Under endosteal we have blade shaped and root form. Under root form we have cylinder and screw shape. Under screw shape we have one piece versus two piece, small diameter implants, bone level versus tissue level, and then implant macrostructure and microstructure. Under macrostructure, parallel walls versus tapered walls, self tapping versus non tapping, and implant threads and micro threads. And under microstructure we have surface therapy. Surface therapy can be additive or subtractive. I hope the content is clear till here. I am concluding this video for today at this point. Okay, the other half of chapter 2 will be discussed in the next video. I hope the entire content is clear to you all. Please go through the textbook simultaneously while watching this video, which will give you more benefits. I am definitely very, very sure. So please keep the textbook with you. My personal suggestion, please follow it. And I hope the content of the today's video is clear to all of you. And I will discuss the next half or the remaining portion of chapter 2 of Karl Misch in the next video. Okay. Thank you for watching and listening to me. If you still have any doubts or any queries, feel free to ask me in the comment section below or to my email ID or my Facebook Messenger or Instagram DM. I will definitely reply to all of you and try to help your people. Please don't hesitate. Ask me as many questions you have with you and I will answer all of them. Thank you for watching and listening to me. Study well. Have a good day. Stay safe.